to Brilliant for supporting this SciShow List Show. Because you watch SciShow, Brilliant is offering you a 30-day free trial and 20% off an annual premium subscription at brilliant.org/scishow. In a time when that whole being alive thing costs more than ever and jobs are tough to come by, it can really sting to see someone get handed everything for free because one of their parents are rich or famous. You know? The trust fund kids, the Nepo babies. We humans might comfort ourselves by saying that at least other animals don't do that. Everyone has to compete for everything, right? Level playing field out there in the wild. Well, no. Plenty of animal species transfer their wealth across generations just as much as we do. Let's meet a few of these privileged species and see the different ways they benefit from the bank account of mom and dad. If we define privilege as differential access to inherited resources, then privilege is alive and well in the animal kingdom. This may seem hard to grasp at first. What, so a mountain gorilla has a trust fund for his kids now? But for an animal, we can refer to wealth as any resource that matters to them. Homes, food, territory, and other things that they need can provide a huge leg up if you get them right off the bat. And animal parents will absolutely provide that edge if they can. After all, it's their genes on the line. This can happen in almost every class of animal on the tree of life, so even bugs and fish can grow up as Nepo babies. Or reptiles, like the White's rock skink. These skinks are monogamous, territorial, and most importantly, social. They bear live young over the course of a couple of days in summer, and the babies will generally live in family groups with the adults. But it's when the little ones grow up that the parental influence comes into play. Many animals disperse, which is to say they leave home, usually in order to find mating opportunities that they won't have at home surrounded by their relatives. And the skinks are no different, except that they only tend to disperse when it's relatively safe to do so. When the population gets high and the local areas are saturated with skinks, the young will often wait longer to disperse, meaning they stay home and get to live in their parents' pre-existing territory with them, basically living in mom and dad's basement after college. A 2017 study showed that skinks who did this had better body condition at the end of the study period, and that might be because the skinks are pretty competitive. Adult skinks will defend their territory from unrelated juveniles. So if a disperser turns up, the study showed they're pretty likely to, well, not make it, especially in scenarios where there was a lot of competition for territory. In those high competition scenarios, juveniles in poorer body condition would wait longer to disperse, crashing in the basement, basically. And that would give them more time to grow up big and strong. While the study didn't follow all of these individuals until they dispersed, it did show that when competition was high, the non-dispersers had better body condition by the end of the study. But with that said, it's only the mother's favorites that get this privilege. Delayed dispersers tended to be the ones that frequently interacted with the mother and had positive associations with her. The mother skink might even bite and chase away her own offspring if she's not friendly with them. So not only are they Nepo babies, the successful skinks that engage in delayed dispersal are mama's boys and girls too. Territory is one of the most important things that an animal can inherit. So we're going to see that it's the animal equivalent of a trust fund in a lot of cases. But in our next animal, the Seychelles warbler, they do things a little differently than the skinks. Warblers will perform a behavior known as territorial budding. This is where chicks will carve out a chunk of the parents' and neighbors' territory to live in. The chicks will then actively defend that territory against other warblers, including the parents they got it from. This is also thought to be a response to territories being heavily saturated with competition. According to a 2001 study, the warblers who inherited the budded areas didn't do all that well to start with, at least in terms of having lots of chicks of their own. However, it did let them stay in good condition and close to high-quality areas, meaning mom and dad's primo real estate, not to mention their rich neighbors. That means the chicks were able to carve out high-quality territory, including from their parents, and enjoyed a high degree of reproductive success for the rest of their lives. So it's like the budded area is the summer home they're crashing in until it comes time for them to inherit the family mansion. Not all warblers were trust fund kids. Some were rarely present in the family territory or anywhere nearby, and others stuck close to the main nest and helped their parents rear their little brothers and sisters. This sounds nice, but neither strategy ever resulted in those warblers inheriting their parents' territory, and it was rare they were ever very successful at all. Both strategies had very low reproductive success success compared to the Butters, and the Helpers actually decreased their parents' success by basically eating them out of house and home. Man, I guess nice warblers really do finish last. Next up is the Black Hover Wasp. They're small social wasps who live in small families, typically between 2 and 4, but the count can go as high as 15. In these family units, there's just one breeding female. The female young have a choice. They can either head off on their own to disperse or stick around and help out the parents. While they're in this stage of their life, the helpers won't breed, although any adult in the small colony technically can do so. But should the current prima donna pass on, that's when they inherit everything. They get the nest and the staff. Their mother's helpers now become theirs. In short, it's a lot easier than having to do everything yourself like the dispersers have to. Of course, there's a strict pecking order here. The other females hanging around effectively line up for this right, with the eldest female being the one to inherit the family business. But 10 years at the top can be short. These wasps' lifespans aren't the longest, so when one family member inherits everything, the rest get to play a risky waiting game. On the one hand, there's a decent chance that the wasp in charge will bite it, and everyone will get to move up in line. On the other, even if she does die, the helpers are still probably raising her young after she's dead, not yours, contributing to her success. While that might sound pretty cutthroat, it's still a good bet compared to the dispersers. If all the females in the colony are related, all their genes are getting passed down. Plus, a lot of the wasps who stick around will get their turn to be a breeder as well, thanks to all the turnover. I'm not sure I could personally handle all that drama. I'm with the dispersers on this one. Which brings us to an even more social insect, termites. Like ants and bees, termites live in big social colonies. Unlike ants and bees, they have both a king and queen at the top. Scientists have exhibited like kind of an alarming amount of interest in what happens when you remove that royal couple. Seriously, we were able to find a weird amount of experiments in different species where researchers took out the king and queen. In the species where it's been done, the kids inherit the throne. Obviously, termites don't have a designated crowned prince or princess. Instead, younger individuals will become sexually mature in order to become the top breeding pair and assume control of the colony. In some cases, they can change from citizen to royalty in just a few weeks, and then become physigastric in a few more. That is what you call it when an ant or termite queen gets all huge and lumpy in their baby-making phase, and I just really wanted to share that fact with you. It's a word, and it's a cool word. For all these experiments, though, it still isn't clear how it's decided exactly who gets the honor of ascending to royalty. There seems to be an element of luck for these Nepo babies, in case you needed a reason to resent them more. Next up is the familiar red squirrel. As we all know, squirrels love nuts, and they're famous for burying them for the winter in big caches which are known as middens. These middens then form the core of their territories, but sometimes females will make more than one and donate the second midden to their offspring. Not all of them do this, only around 20% according to one study, and it's specifically the most experienced individuals. On top of that, certain environmental conditions can make it more likely for the mothers to give such a generous gift to their young. A 2015 study found they did so in lean years, specifically ones where the next year things were looking a lot better. Maybe because they knew they'd be able to find their own food resources in better times. But the parents that do this are giving their kids a huge boost. It increases their chances of securing their own territory around that midden, and they probably won't be surviving the winter without that. This is also good for the parent, since she's improving her kid's chance of passing on her own genes. It really is amazing the difference a small loan of a million acorns makes to a squirrel's chances in life. But our most privileged Nepo baby is the spotted hyena. There may not be another animal whose future is decided so completely by who their parents are. The hyenas live in groups that usually have a matriarch at the top. Cubs inherit their social rank from their mother, slotting in right below her position. So how does this translate into actual benefits for them? Well, for a start, more and better food. High-ranking ladies grab more food from kills, and so eat better and produce more milk for their baby cubs, meaning healthier babies. This also means the cubs are weaned sooner and grow faster. High-rankers also win out in interactions with other hyenas due to the social support they get from the rest of their group. Kind of like having a posse to back you up. Naturally, this privilege is extended to the young as well. So overall, everyone has their back and they get the choice cuts, It's already looking pretty good. But just like so many animals we've talked about, male hyenas tend to disperse to find mates they're not related to. And they still continue to benefit. High-born boys will continue to reap the rewards of their mother's rank their whole lives. They disperse into clans with more young females for them as mates. High-ranking moms set them up for success from an early age, feeding them better and helping them live longer overall. That means higher status young males can invest more time and energy into searching for and building relationships with suitable future mates. As a result, these males have a higher reproductive success rate than males with lower status moms. All in all, the kids of the mothers at the top will continue to benefit significantly from that association their entire life. Many of these examples show that in nature, Nepo babies are a way for parents to increase their own evolutionary success, basically making sure they'll have grandkids who will continue to pass on their genes. As frustrating as it might feel, these animals are really just doing what's best for their kids. And it's hard to fault them for that. Thanks for watching this SciShow List show, and thanks to Brilliant for supporting it. Brilliant makes online learning interactive with thousands of lessons in science, computer science, and math, like their course on computational biology. You know how ancestry and evolution are all intertwined in the lives of these Nepo babies? Well, they're also connected by the principles of computational biology, and this Brilliant course will explain how. Brilliant courses are interactive and filled with puzzles to keep you engaged, so you can contextualize what you learned in this SciShow video and enjoy the ride. To get started, go to brilliant.org/scishow or click the link in the description down below. That link also gives you 20% off an annual premium Brilliant subscription, and you'll get your first 30 days for free. Thanks for learning with us.